Hard Sun is a dark detective drama set in London. It basically opens where Elaine Renko, my character, is brutally attacked in her own home. And then she's bribed by her work colleagues higher up. She's a detective inspector. She basically has to go and take this other job to investigate Robert Hicks, which Jim plays. So I take a job. I am forced to take a job to investigate him. And while we're on the job, and we come across this like classified government dossier that basically says the world's going to end in 5 years. And so MI5's after us. And knowing this information is deadly. So it's how we approach the terrain of one being the only people that knows this is going to happen, also being very suspicious and not liking each other very much, and getting through it, trying to save our families. I mean, Elaine Renko, like, you see her at first and it's just like so intense physically, you know, she's fighting, she's being attacked, but she's holding her own. So you just think, like, how is this person, like, trained to fight like this? And you just realise that, you know, she's had a very, very hard childhood, a very abusive relationships, and she's had to, like, take care of herself. Like, no one else will look after her, no one else will take care of her, no one else will save her apart from herself. So she's very self-sufficient, she's an island, she's very introverted, but super, super intelligent. And she goes into the police force and becomes a detective inspector because she wants to right her own wrongs. So you kind of meet her at this time in her life when stuff's kind of unraveling, you know, and she's not in control anymore, and she's put in this situation kind of like a carrot and a donkey kind of thing. Basically, it's her son. And she's just so strong and so decisive. When I read it, I just like, who is this woman? You take away all the projections of what a woman should be and all the sexuality that's kind of put on someone in film and TV, and you kind of take away gender and you have this human to human story about two partners that really dislike each other and are secretive and kind of have to come together, you know, to solve you know, the problems that they're going through and to be supportive in this time that no one else understands. So, I mean, working with Jim was, it was just really cool. Like, when you approach a material that's so dark and so challenging, to have someone that you can, one, get along with, two's like, you know, your champion. So you just kind of, you know, he's the person that picks you up and then you pick him up, you know, when we have these like crazy days and doing night shoots and stuff. So it kind of just clicked in a lot of ways that when you kind of trying to portray a complex, difficult relationship on screen, to have the opposite off screen is really, really fun, because then you can just leave all that at the door and have a bit of a laugh. So it was really cool in that way. One, Neil has such a vivid, fantastic imagination. And to the writing, like, he writes, the language that he writes, we don't change it. We don't change anything. And that was, we knew that from the get-go, that the language is something that is a very important part of the show, to keep it timeless, you know, to make it, to create the world. And the language is very important. So, and specifically to each character. And that was very important, I know, to Neil, and it was really cool working with him on, you know, being like, why am I doing that, and why am I saying that, and to really, like, play tennis with him and really understand the material was so fun, especially, like, with a mind so brilliant. So, yeah, it was just so cool to work with someone that is so brilliant, and also you don't never get to work that closely with the writers, you know, on things, you know, you just kind of, so we work very closely with Neil, and then Brian, the director of the first block, so we were kind of like winning, like, from the get-go, fingers crossed. I don't know whether it's because people's fascination with death, life and death, and, you know, every, like, a human urge, the main human urge in life is to survive. But if you have, like, an apocalypse, you impede in that survival. So I think that the fascination comes around this thing that we don't understand, which is death. We don't know what happens after death. And I think that in modern day society, especially in the Western world, we don't live in war-torn countries, you know. We actually live like a Western civilized life. So the concept of the other is one terrifying. It's like two, something that we don't actually know. So I think that just something that we have a high interest to understand and we're not experiencing in this moment.
What are you most hoping overall people take away from the series?
That they enjoy it, that they go on this like exhilarating ride. It's like 1,000 miles an hour to be entertained, to be afraid, to be invigorated. And also, like, it kind of then posts questions of, like, what would I do if I had so much time to live, and how would I react, and would I make amends to this person, and would I act in a different way if I knew the world was going to end, and how you can just do that in your everyday life. So, yeah, it just heightens everything. It's definitely an intense ride. It's not for the faint of heart.
Well, I play a character called DCI Charlie Hicks, you know, who's a very, very experienced detective, very good detective. You know, he's a working class guy from London who's really kind of worked his way up through the ranks, you know, sort of joined the force probably very young and, you know, has sort of operated throughout the police force on a very sort of ground street level. So, you know, being a working class guy from London, he's very sort of used to being around the sort of criminal underworld and very used to sort of dealing with criminals. And the idea being that, I guess, had he not taken a path into the police force, he probably could have himself ended up as a criminal, you know. So he kind of is a bit of a law unto himself, really, and slightly corrupt in some ways. And, you know, someone who's very comfortable bending and breaking the rules in order to achieve what he believes to be the kind of greater good, you know. Well, very quickly, you know, he's partnered with Agnes's character, Elaine Renko, which instantly sort of starts to twist a very sort of unique and difficult dynamic between the two characters, and they're kind of forced to work with each other. She is secretly being hired to investigate my character for a crime that I may or may not have committed, and my involvement in the murder of my best friend and partner. So we're then on our first case, our first murder case, we discover a flash drive. And on that flash drive is very important withheld information that the government are holding back, that is a dossier called Hard Sun, which is basically a file stating that the world is going to end in 5 years. So they kind of are the, you know, it's about how they kind of deal with that information and how they carry that secret on their shoulders, how that affects their relationship as partners. And, you know, the government are also tracking them down, who will stop at nothing, you know, and are prepared to kill to keep the secret under wraps. So already, and that's all in the first episode. So, I mean, you know, it's a whirlwind of action and intricate kind of dynamics between the characters. Agnes sort of came with so much determination and was so kind of like driven to, you know, get inside of the skin of Renko, who is a seriously complicated and damaged character, you know. So it required a lot of work, and I was blessed because me and Agnes get on really well in real life, and it's such a tricky, complicated relationship between the characters that it was really important that we got along, that we were able to kind of freely discuss and sort of go to quite dark and difficult places together. Otherwise, it would have been a nightmare, you know. That, you know, it's so sort of complex as the two characters are trying to wrong-foot each other and outdo each other, and are both very good at their jobs but come at their work from completely different perspectives, you know. So they're kind of actually, by the pure nature of being detectives, they're investigating each other. And Agnes's character is very much, you know, been hired to investigate my character for the death of my ex-partner. You know, so, yeah, it was complicated, and it required a lot of discussion and a lot of work, and we had to do some fairly horrific sort of fight scenes together. So it was important that we, you know, we had a strong bond on set and that we kind of got along. to kind of, you know, have the trust in each other to go to those places, you know. This show starts off at 100 miles an hour. It literally does, you know, and it doesn't stop. And each episode just gets further and further, as you get further and further into the whole concept and the whole problem of Hard Sun. You know, he knows how to sort of tackle violence and make violence quite visceral and quite sort of in your face, and but it comes with repercussions, you know. And he knows how to sort of put characters together, you know, damaged, interesting, flawed and brilliant, caring characters. I mean, my character's like no character I've ever played. There are even times when I had to email Neil and say, what's going on? Like, can you explain to me what's happening? Because I'm so kind of, he sort of wrong-foots the audience a lot, and it wrong-footed me. And he's not just a corrupt cop. You know, we've seen that on TV many times. There's a very detailed sort of look into somebody who, you know, has the capacity to love on quite a big level, you know, and it forces him to do quite questionable things, you know. And so you've got all these characters that are existing in this really incredible grey zone, you know. It's not heroes and villains, and it's not good and bad. It's just a lot of confused and damaged people kind of trying to figure out their way in the world, you know. And then you twin that with this giant concept, you know, that you put it under this umbrella of the world coming to an end, and just seeing how extreme human behavior can really kind of be, and you know, how darkness can get even darker when there's, you know, when people are desperate, you know.
Why do you think as a species we are so fascinated with the concept of our own demise?
I mean, it's the ultimate concept, isn't it? It's the ultimate kind of idea that everything could just disappear, you know. And I love that about the show, that it sort of forces you to look out further out, you know. It forces you to kind of perceive the world we live in from space, you know, and to sort of see us floating on this rock in the middle of, you know, the solar system. It gives you a very interesting perspective, you know. And the fact that it could all disappear, and if that did come about, how would we deal with that? How would society deal with that? And I think that's what's great about it as a TV show, is because you can actually spend time with the characters, with the concept, and really look into how are people going to deal with knowing that the world is going to end. Is it going to just totally turn into chaos and an unlawful, you know, society? Are people going to turn to religion? Are people going to turn their back on religion and go against religion? You know, so there's all these really interesting ideas that the kind of show kind of brings up. All the while, you know, it's really a story about family, and it's about, you know, how you try and protect your loved ones and look after the people that you love, you know. I think ultimately, you know, I mean, we talked about it a lot, you know, and there are people that are going to want to cause chaos. There's going to be people that want to find peace, you know, and make sure that the last sort of days on earth are full of love and, you know, tranquility. And then there's going to be people who want to just tear the place apart, you know. And I think I can relate to sort of Hicks's situation, in which you would just want to protect and make sure that the people that you love, you were close to the people that you love, you know, and that you try and help them through something like that as much as possible, you know. So, yeah, there were sort of relatable themes in that sense. Yeah, I think above all, I just hope they're entertained, you know. I hope they're kind of along for the ride, and I hope they're kind of shocked and excited and touched and intrigued and scared. But I think ultimately, you know, I do think it would be, you know, it'd be really interesting if it did force people to look at life and their own relationships with people around them and the planet that we live on, and sort of think about that in quite a deep and sort of profound way, you know.
So I play a character called Detective Chief Superintendent Roland Bell, who's in charge of Renko and Hicks. He has a bit of history with Hicks. They don't really get on particularly well. And before the first episode starts, Hicks's partner, DCI Butler, has died under kind of suspicious circumstances, and he is suspicious that Hicks might be involved in this, and so part of his job in this is to bring Hicks to justice. So he's kind of, Hicks is this sort of renegade cop, and my character is this hard-nosed, seen-it-all Glaswegian detective chief superintendent who's also under pressure from people higher than him as well to bring Hicks to justice, but also the pressure of what's been released with the Hard Sun information and keeping the public trying to keep the public unaware of that and hiding stuff because the government's onto them as well. They're just, their relationship in this, they really carry this show. It's their, you know, you've got to be invested in Renko and Hicks in this it's about their characters more than anything else. I'm in it, but it's about them. And I think they have a really great relationship in it. And it's this fact about who knows what at the right time, who's spying on who, what information they have. And that's always being played out between the two of them through the episodes. They find out more about each other that they didn't know, and then that affects the way in which they behave to each other. And I think by the end, probably, I'm trying to remember, they, you know, come together a bit more. Whereas at first they're maybe a bit of loggerheads and suspicious of each other, they come together by the end to try and defeat everything that's going on.
And what's unique about a Neil Cross script?
I think it's he's not scared to go into sort of weird and dark territory, and I think this, particularly in the later episodes, it goes, takes you to places that you don't expect, and it's quite gruesome and it's quite dark. They were going for sort of feel of a graphic novel in this, I think, when we were filming it. And so, whereas people will know his work from Luther, which again was dark and weird, but this is a slightly, I would say that's more naturalistic, and this is more, like I say, a graphic novel idea with look and script. You have to ask yourself, what would you do if time was running out? What would you do if you know you only had 5 years left? Would you still stick to all the norms, all the laws, or would you just go, oh, forget it, we're all going to go, so I might as well enjoy myself and misbehave? But I don't know if I can make it last for 5 years of misbehaving. But I think that's why, because I think the rules have all changed and people would not probably act. I think that's what the show does. It shows you people acting in ways that they wouldn't normally do. I think I would probably grab my children and start travelling the world and let them see places that they'd heard about and hadn't seen, and just enjoy my time with my family if I knew that was a limited amount of time. I think that's definitely what I would do.
I'm really excited, though I will say I'm still really scared watching the show. It's really scary and really on the edge of your seat. So, I'm quite excited, but also a little apprehensive. And it's really weird seeing yourself on screen. I don't think it ever gets easier seeing your face multiplied by 1,000 in front of a lot of people. It's sort of quite a vulnerable thing to be in. So, yeah. My storyline will develop more as we go on, less about the apocalyptic nature and more about Jim's character's private life. So, yeah, that part of it is more to be revealed. At the moment, she's someone who has, I don't want to give any spoilers away, but she's got quite a complicated relationship with him. So that sort of develops more and more, and she ends up kind of getting pulled into proceedings as he gets manipulated by Nikki's character. So it's all very entangled. Do you know what? There are a lot of talented people in the world, and so many people can bring characters to life. But more and more in this industry, you start to value people who are good, who behind the scenes are kind. Both Jim and Agnes were dealing with a huge amount during this shoot. They were getting beaten up and doing long sequences at night, often in the freezing cold. And they are both lovely, kind people, and were so, always so warm to be around. And even when you're doing a small scene in the day when they have such other big things going on, they were just such generous actors. And there's so much negativity out in the world, and you know, it's really nice to meet actors like that who have very high profiles but are also very warm and loving. And that's kind of what makes them the most unique, in my opinion, that they're great to work with. Neil Cross, who wrote Luther as well, is such an exciting writer. Normally, as an actor, when you read a script, you read it and you look for your own lines and kind of highlight your own lines. You're like, what am I doing in it? I read this like a book, like I read it like a thriller. And it's rare that you get a script that you read like a book like that. It's such a page turner. I couldn't wait to find out what happens next. Even the way he describes what happens in the scene are so visceral. You feel the person falling out of the tree and getting impaled. There's a scene or two in the final episode that will really have you just like that. So it's very exciting to be part of one of Neil's projects because he's just incredibly talented. Why are we so fascinated with the concept of our own demise? Well, it's not a crazy idea considering that the President of the United States of America is tweeting about setting off a nuclear war. It's not the most impossible thing in the world right now. So we either are fascinated with it and watch programmes like Hard Sun or want to run away and watch The Bake Off. So it's one or the other. So that's I suppose I seesaw between watching Hard Sun and The Bake Off. That would be my ideal evening. Hard Sun, panic! Ah, a cake. I mean, the interesting thing is, and I suppose maybe humans haven't gotten their head around this, the world could end in 5 years for any of us. We don't get to live forever. I'm sorry if that's a showbiz exclusive, that you don't live forever. I feel like we're all already spending so much time on social media that in a panic, we would just watch The Bake Off and scroll through our Instagram, and then the 5 years would be up and we're like, what, already? So I feel like we would all love to think we'd go travelling and discover a new species of frog, but in reality, we'd probably all waste our time just eating a load of biscuits. I'd say we'd all get really overweight and be like, ugh, how nice to just chill out and know that you never have to, like, do any exercise again. And you can just eat biscuits and burgers. Like, just throw it all in the bit. Like, that's what I do. I just sit around eating burgers all day. Yeah. And I'd say that would be a life well lived.
I'm playing the part of Daniel, who's a sort of really messed up kid who sort of snapped and tries to lash out everyone around him. And that gets me somehow very much entwined with everything about Hard Sun, and I become right in the middle of it. And I don't know, I like to think I am the Hard Sun.
Talk particularly about Neil's writing and what is so very special about a Neil Cross script.
Yeah, well, I remember when I first read it, I was sitting in bed with a crumpet, and I was reading through the script. I was thinking, it grabs you straight away, gets you straight in, and by the time you get to the end of it, I literally had a few pages of it, got to the end of it, I was like, oh, I've got to see more. It's incredible. Like, the way he writes just grabs you straight away. And like, if you feel that way just when you're reading the script, like, hopefully, and I think it has come across in a way which is going to be incredibly addictive over the TV. I think everyone loves doom and gloom. Nobody knows what's going to happen. No one knows what's going to happen at the end of the world. And because this is, well, it's pre-apocalyptic, I think everyone's being say. So it's quite interesting watching how everyone prepares and changes towards the end of the world, which I think is what everyone really imagines. No one imagines what happens afterwards. I think they imagine what just happens just before and what the hell would you do when it's all going horribly wrong.
How do you think you would handle living in the world of Hard Sun yourself?
I wouldn't handle it well. I mean, I'd probably get a bit wild. I don't know, I'd do some stupid things. You know, you want to be with the people who you're close with. Maybe go and do all the stuff you've never been brave enough to do before. Go and buy an enormous hat and wear it down the street. Bring platform boots back into fashion. You know, things like that, I think I'd probably do. Daniel, however, reacts a bit differently. Not so many platform boots, a lot more knives. It is violent. And my character, Daniel, especially, is, I think in virtually every scene I'm in, especially when I'm acting with someone else, I nearly every time try and kill them. So there's quite a lot of violence and there's quite a lot of graphic stuff, which I hope's come through because I ended up getting very, very bruised and battered doing it. No regrets. But I don't think it's not like a stupid, intense violence. It's not like it's there just for the sake of it. I don't know. I think it's going to come off really nicely and not too intense, but it will be there. It's bloodthirsty in a good way. It's great fun. That's the interesting stuff. That's the good ones. The maniacs. The evil, the bad guys, basically. Which Daniel, I suppose, in some senses, is a bit of a bad guy. But it's the same thing with everyone in Hard Sun. Everyone's sort of a bad guy and a good guy at the same time. Which is one of the things that makes the show really interesting for me. But yeah, it's difficult getting to grips with someone that is so far detached from what society usually expects from you. But it's been great fun getting to know Daniel, and getting to play him was a real honour.
Talk, I guess, particularly about, I guess, Jim and Agnes, and what makes them both such very special performers.
They're both an absolute honour to act opposite. It's great. Like, you can throw anything at them and they come back at you. Like, for instance, I come in there like a sort of mad, deranged flower pot man, waving myself around, usually trying to stab people. And yet they can still act against that and very, very professional, even when I'm trying to attack them both, which is always good. That's always a good sign. But no, they're very talented and they're going to be a real pleasure to watch.
What is the one thing overall you're most hoping an audience takes away from the experience of Hard Sun?
I hope that everyone's going to sit down for a bit of nice evening TV, flick on the telly, and next thing you know, they're going to be sat on the sofa, sweating. No idea what's going to happen next. Anything could happen next in Hard Sun. It usually does. Usually the most mad thing happens, and I hope everyone finds that really entertaining, and I hope it gets people gripped from the word go.
The original inspiration was a kind of collision of two separate ideas. I had the two characters who became Renko and Hicks kind of popped into my head one day. I had this idea of two characters who stood entirely antithetically to one another, ethically and morally. I want to tell a kind of an anti-buddy story. They're two people who mistrusted each other with profoundly good reason, but who were forced by circumstance to become at least allies. And we knew they were never going to fall in love. We knew they were never going to be friends. But what we wanted to see was to see them trust one another and to follow them on that kind of story, which I thought was a kind of relationship we hadn't really seen on TV. So I had the notion of these two people in this relationship, but no sense of the world in which it took place. And then one day at home, I was editing my books, as I do a couple of times a year, kind of pulling books from the shelf and putting them in boxes, ready to go to charity. And I was playing David Bowie's album, Ziggy Stardust and the Spiders from Mars, the first song on which is called 5 Years. And since I was a kid, since I was, I guess, 15 or 16, it's been one of my favorite songs. It's a song in which the narrator, the character Bowie plays in the song, has just learned that the world has got 5 years left. And what in lesser hands could have been kind of maudlin and nihilistic instead becomes a celebration of the moment and a celebration of life. He looks out at kind of London in all its multiplicity and its vastness and all the tall, short people and all the fat, skinny people. And instead of reveling in nihilism, it becomes a kind of joyous and uplifting experience. And as I was listening to the song, putting these books in boxes, I suddenly thought, okay, that's the world. That's the world that Renko and Hicks can live in. So let's put these two characters in that particular kind of fractious, distrustful relationship, and let's put them in a world that's got 5 years left. The fascination for apocalypse is abiding. It transcends all narrative, all cultures, all time. There's always been an end times narrative, but I don't think it's nihilistic, because when we imagine those stories, when we tell those stories to ourselves, when we watch those stories being told, we're identifying with the survivors, not with the dead. And I think actually what those stories are about is not about destruction, but about transformation. And we're imagining how our lives would be if they were stripped back to the bare essentials. If all of the quotidian everyday problems that we all deal with every day were stripped away, and it all was left was the people we cared about and how we'd survive. I think these stories are a way of us exploring our fantasies and our aspirations to be our best selves. Apocalypse narratives are actually stories about us being at our absolute best. It's very difficult to talk about casting in any objective way, because casting is a process, and it's a process of discovery. Sometimes it's joyful, sometimes it's complicated, but in this particular instance, we had a complicated problem to deal with. We had to cast both the roles as well as we could, but we also had to hope that each of the actors cast worked well together, that there was a kind of on-screen chemistry there. And there was a... going into it, it looked like it was going to be a big and difficult task, and in fact it wasn't. Because as soon as we saw Aggie, we knew, and as soon as we saw Jim, we knew. It was easy.
Violence and darkness is a big element of much of your work, particularly in Hard Sun, I think. Can you talk a little bit about the character of violence in Hard Sun as a series?
Yeah, it's a question I'm asked often, and I've never had a satisfactory answer for it. And the truth is, I've got nothing to say about, you know, with a capital S, about any important subject. I have no message to convey. I am the vehicle of no important truth. I do really like telling stories which frighten and excite people. And the violence in Hard Sun is never gratuitous, but it is always there for a particular storytelling purpose. It's there to thrill and to frighten and excite. That's its only function. And we don't want to, you know, we don't want to upset people. We try to keep it within the limits of taste. If I could explode a head, I would, but obviously we can't do that. So it's there as part of the warp and the weft of the created world. It's literal conflict. We are doing some more Luther. We start shooting a new series in January. But I don't know if you've ever heard the expression that you've got a different stomach for dessert. My head's like that for Luther and Hard Sun. I've got entirely separate, independent portions of my head. And heart, actually, are given over to Luther and to Hard Sun. They're entirely independent entities. One of the unusual opportunities afforded by Luther is to take a character and an actor that people love and devise new ways to put him through hell. So that's a great pleasure to me. It's how am I going to make Luther suffer this time, and how am I going to make it worse and therefore better than last time? So there's a kind of malicious glee to be had in that.
Idris is widely accepted as one of our great national treasures. Can you talk about, for you, what makes him such a unique and very important performer for this country?
It's very difficult to articulate that. I think one of the... I know him so well, it's very difficult to articulate this, is that what you see with Idris is what you get, that he really is a genuinely kind, genuinely gentle, genuinely good-hearted man. So I think people... how can I articulate this? When people see Idris, they see the kind of person he is. There is no artifice, there's no lie. That's who Idris Elba is, and he's a genuinely lovely human being.
We've got more Luther. Is Hard Sun something that you think could have the same kind of longevity?
Well, we hope so. I have a cunning Stalin-esque 5-year plan for Hard Sun. And again, like Luther, the show is designed to start ostensibly resembling a cop show. And over the course of, well, really one episode, but subsequent episodes, we see that it's something else entirely. And it's written in the show's DNA that it can develop and change into any number of interesting directions.